Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Muhammad Akil and we are from Group 1 and we will be presenting about Nikolsky sign. There are a few things that will be discussed in this presentation. The first one is the introduction. The second is variance of Nikolsky sign. The third contents is oral manifestation. The fourth management and the last contents is the guest reports. So firstly, we go to the introduction. Nikolsky sign has been a very useful diagnostic tools in many cases of skin disorders such as toxic epidermolysis, staphylococcal scaldal skin syndrome or SSSS and pemphigus. The Nikolsky sign is demonstrated when the normal epidermis is dislodged when lateral pressure is applied to the border of an intact blister, which then causes the extension of the blister. In 1858 to 1940, this clinical pathological sign was first described by this doctor or dermatologist at the University of Warsaw, and he is called Dr. Piotr Wasilewicz Nikolsky. And in 1896, Dr. Nikolsky finally presented an explanation for the phenomenon and how this sign works. According to Dr. Nikolsky, the sign indicated a deteriorating relationship between the cornea and granular layers of all surfaces, including between the lesions on apparently unaffected skin. There are many different types of Nikolsky sign, as you can see there, but the most common ones are wet Nikolsky sign and dry Nikolsky sign. The marginal and direct Nikolsky sign also one of the types, as is the other types of Nikolsky sign. So there is also macroscopic Nikolsky sign, which is a good and sensitive method for rapid diagnosis. There are also fast Nikolsky sign or Shklyakov sign, and pseudo Nikolsky sign, or we call it epidermal peeling sign. These variant types of Nikolsky sign will be explained in the next LO. For your additional information, Nikolsky sign is also one of the diagnostic tools in oral disease, such as mucous membrane pemphigoid and pemphigus vulgaris. Mucous membrane pemphigoid is the most common autoimmune bullous disorder in the oral cavity. So oral healthcare professional should consider using the Nikolsky signs for the early diagnosis of autoimmune bullous disorder, which could lead to the early diagnosis of these two diseases or the other disease.
Assalamualaikum, my name is Muhammad Ramzi. I'm going to continue for the variants of the Nikolsky sign. So first, let's have a look, shall we? We have a total of 7 variants of Nikolsky sign. The first one is the marginal Nikolsky. The second one is the direct Nikolsky sign. The third one is the modified Nikolsky sign. The fourth one is the wet Nikolsky sign. The fifth one is the pseudo Nikolsky sign or the epidermal peeling sign. The sixth one, we have the dry Nikolsky sign. And the last one is the Shklyakov sign or the false Nikolsky sign. We're going to go through them one by one. So first, let's have a look at the marginal Nikolsky. It can be seen over the normal looking skin of a pemphigus patient close to existing lesion. Pemphigus is a group of potentially life-threatening disorder characterized by blister in the mucous membrane and skin. The marginal Nikolsky sign is demonstrated when the rubbing of skin surrounding the existing lesion causes the extension of erosion on the surrounding normal skin. The second one, we have the direct Nikolsky sign. It is a Nikolsky sign that can be seen over the normal looking skin at a distant site. A positive direct Nikolsky sign indicates a severe activity of the disease in a pemphigus patient. For the third one, the modified Nikolsky sign, it is the peripheral extension of blister when applying pressure to the surface. This is helpful if the patient's new vesicle or bulla is not available for biopsy. The advantage here is that artificially extended blister do not show epithelial regeneration, which may sometimes be seen in floor of older subepidermal blister, making them appear as intraepidermal. For the wet Nikolsky sign, in which a moist glistening base of eroded skin is seen after pressure is exerted on the skin. For the fifth one, the pseudo Nikolsky sign or the epidermal peeling sign, it is positive in the Stevens-Johnson syndrome, the toxic epidermal necrolysis, burns, and also the bullous ichthyosiform erythroderma. The method of eliciting is the same as that for the Nikolsky sign. In these cases, the underlying pathophysiology is necrosis, which is seen in the true Nikolsky sign. It can be seen only on areas that are already affected and also on the erythematous area. There is a phenomenon associated with this sign called the Nikolsky phenomenon. Here, the superficial epidermis is felt to move over the deeper layers. And instead of an immediate reaction to form erosion as in the Nikolsky sign, the blisters develop after some time. The sixth one, the dry Nikolsky sign, in which a dry base of eroded skin is seen after the pressure is exerted on the skin. And also, for the last one, the Sheklakov sign or the false Nikolsky sign, this is positive in the subepidermal blistering disorder like the Ballard's pemphigoid, the satricial pemphigoid, the pemphigoid gestationis, dermatitis, herpetiformis, linear IgA Ballard's dermatosis, epidermolysis bullosa acquisita, the junctional and dystrophic epidermolysis bullosa, the porphyrias, and also the Ballard's systemic lupus erythematosus. For subepidermal blistering disorder, the false Nikolsky sign is positive because the extension of the erosion on surrounding normal skin is caused by the pulling of the peripheral remnant roof of a ruptured blister. It is called a false Nikolsky sign because it is a subepidermal cleavage occurring in the perilesional skin.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. So now I'm going to present about the oral manifestations of Nikolsky sign. What is Nikolsky sign? Nikolsky sign is not a disease, but rather it is an important diagnostic tool. For example, for autoimmune bullous diseases. So what is autoimmune bullous diseases? Autoimmune bullous diseases are a group of rare chronic blistering diseases that affect the skin and mucous membranes. So this is according to Endo 2019. Most frequently occurring autoimmune bullous disease in the oral cavity is the mucous membrane pemphigoid, or also known as MMP, followed by pemphigus vulgaris or PV. So here you can see in the picture, or in this image, this is what we call as a positive Nikolsky sign, where the skin is dislodged when applied pressure onto it. So these are the some of the oral manifestations. So in this case, there is this formative gingivitis in mucous membrane pemphigoid, the autoimmune bullous diseases in the oral cavity. The intensity of the gingival erythema here, gingival erythema or erosion is variable. The erosion, we can say that the Nikolsky signs is positive, and the involvement may be diffuse or patchy distributions. Okay, so these are also the dysquamative gingivitis, but in the case of pemphigus vulgaris, also an autoimmune bullous disease in the oral cavity, the attached gingiva presents a friable nature of the tissue, and bullae develop quickly and then rupture, leaving eroded painful surfaces with wagged borders. So because of this rupture or positive Nikolsky sign, we can diagnose this as an autoimmune bullous diseases, or specifically pemphigus vulgaris. Next oral manifestation. Okay, Nikolsky sign in pemphigus vulgaris. The epithelium is dislodged. Yes, this is the important point. Nikolsky sign in a positive Nikolsky sign. The epithelium is dislodged by the application of a firm sliding force. Okay, so we can diagnose this case, or we can include pemphigus vulgaris as the differential diagnosis of this case. Okay, the last oral manifestation is this one. We can see that the Nikolsky sign with bleeding in mucus in this area, with bleeding in mucous membrane pemphigoid or MMP. Gingival bleeding can occur in some patients characterized by subepithelial blister formation. So that's the use of Nikolsky sign.
Assalamualaikum. My name is Aiman Ashmi bin Badr Hisham, and I will present about the management of the Nikolsky sign. So the diagnosis to detect the Nikolsky sign in the patient. First one, we can do the clinical examination such as taking their medical history or family history, because we know that Nikolsky sign is an autoimmune disease. So the next one, we can take the histopathologic findings such as we can take the sample of the patient such as his saliva, his blood to determine the specific bacteria of the Nikolsky sign. And the last one is the DIF test or direct immunofluorescent test. So as the treatment for the Nikolsky sign, the conditions associated with Nikolsky signs can be serious. Some people need to be admitted to the hospital, and usually the patient will be asked about the medical history and given physical examination. The treatment usually will depend on the cause of the condition. So this is the option that has been provided to treat the Nikolsky sign. So the first one is giving fluid and antibiotic through a vein or IV. We know the antibiotic will help in destroy or slow down the bacteria. The second option is giving petroleum jelly to decrease pain, such as giving the Vaseline to the patient. And the last one is local wound care to prevent further infection.
Assalamualaikum. My name is Niki Alisa. My friend Afrika and I will discuss about the case report regarding this topic with the title of pemphigus vulgaris, which is a rare case of gingival involvement. This case is about the patient who is a 32 years old woman who also a homemaker, who were reported to the Department of Dentistry with the chief complaints of burning sensation in the gums, pain when brushing and eating, painful gingival erosion, and also gingival discoloration for past 8 months. She also unable to eat or drink adequately. The detail of family history was obtained and it was a non-contributory. Next, I am going to talk about the laboratory findings. The first one is cytological smear. Cytological smear were prepared by exfoliating from the labial surface of gingiva. And the result show some cell, which is also known as a cantalytic cell, showing slight high nuclear cytoplasmic ratio with well-defined nuclear outline. Second one is biopsy. Biopsy was drawn from a perilesional site with involved gingival surface, and biopsy is necessary because the acantholytic cells alone are not a definitive diagnosis of pemphigus vulgaris, but it is only a presumptive diagnosis, as the acantholytic cells may also appear in other diseases. So the reason biopsy need to do is to determine the definitive diagnosis. And the last one is histopathological examination. The result from histopathological examination show supervascular separation, which is as shown in the picture, formation of tombstone appearance, and the dermis show mild perivascular inflammation. It's all from me.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Nora Afika Minti Mohamed, and I will proceed the case presentation report with clinical findings. So upon clinical findings, extraoral examination revealed no skin lesions. A dermatologist confirmed the absence of any cutaneous lesions, and other mucosal sites such as pinjang saliva, nasal, genital, and esophageal mucosa were also free of lesions. Next, periodontal examination revealed no calculus and plaque formation, and there was no attachment and bone loss. Next is intraoral examination. Intraoral examination reveals denuded and spontaneously bleeding gingival mucosa. The gingival mucosa also exhibited a positive Nikolsky sign, and the epithelium could be peeled away easily by slightly scratching the surface of the gingiva. It was also reported that there was a presence of white patches, ulcerative and erythematous area on the gingival surface. The gingiva appeared reddish blue, soft and erythematous and bleeding on probing. The site that was most severely affected was her gingival surface, specifically the attached marginal and interdental gingival, with no involvement of oral mucosa, tongue or palate. And those appearance can be seen in figure 1. So in this figure 1, we can see the intraoral view showing gingival desquamation. Jim Jaipal, this commission is a clinical term that may represent the oral clinical manifestation of various systemic mucocutaneous diseases. These most often include mucous membrane pemphigoid, lichen planus, or pemphigus vulgaris. Therefore, biopsy and histopathological examination are needed to make a definitive diagnosis of the disease responsible for the gingival desquamation. So now I will proceed with the definitive diagnosis. So a definitive diagnosis of pemphigus vulgaris was made based on the clinical and histopathological findings. Pemphigus vulgaris patient, the treatment plan includes first, steroid medication, corticosteroid, with systemic corticosteroids as the treatment of choice in patients with pemphigus vulgaris. Second is periodontal therapy, which includes frequent professional oral prophylaxis, 0.2% chlorhexidine mouth rinse, the power toothbrushes for home care, and the removal of local irritating factors such as sharp cups of the teeth in order to minimize the irritation. And third, if higher dosage of steroids are needed or significant steroid side effects experienced by the patient, adjuvant immunosuppressants such as azathioprine or cyclophosphamide are added to the regimen. So that is the end of our presentation from Group 1. Thank you.